that trouble me. Many are they that rise up against me. Many a bewitched say of my soul, there is no help for him in God. But thou, O Lord,
Next, we'll be encouraged to rise up in faith to work. And this encouragement will be given by Pastor Aaron Sutherland from the island of Trinidad.
Pleasant good day to each and every one who is viewing this broadcast. My name is Pastor Aaron Sutherland, and I am the pastor of Calvary Fundamental Baptist Church here in Trinidad and Tobago. It is indeed my distinct honor to be able to preach for the West Indies Baptist Fellowship Conference. And this morning I've been given the topic, Rise Up in Faith to Work. Beloved, as we look at that theme this morning, let us turn in our Bibles to Nehemiah chapter 2. Nehemiah chapter 2. And the Bible says, Then said I unto them, in verse 17, Then said I unto them, Ye see the distresses that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come and let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we be no more a reproach. Then I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me, as also the king's word that he had spoken unto me. And they said, Let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for this good work. Beloved, let us look to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come before your throne of grace. Father, I ask, O God, Lord, that as I come before your throne, that, Lord, that you would use this word to please yourself. And, Lord, that those who hear it would be challenged by it. But Lord, I ask that you would speak to me and through me as well. Challenge everyone who would be hearing. And Lord, I ask, O God, Lord, that you would just continue to touch our hearts as we look to your word and this theme, rise up in faith to work. Lord, it is a theme of practicality. So, Lord, I ask that you help me to show that. So, Father, these things we do ask that you grant. In Jesus Christ's name we ask with thanksgiving. Amen and amen. Beloved, in order for us to understand this theme and where we are going in the book of Nehemiah, we have to understand the background of the passage. God in the book of Genesis called Abraham, the father of the Israelite people, and gave him the promise that he would give him descendants as much as the stars in the sky and as much as the sand on the seashore, but also that whosoever would bless him, that they would be blessed, and whosoever would curse him, that they would be cursed. That blessing and that promise, that covenant, would have been handed down to his descendants as well. Eventually, over time, the Israelites found themselves in Egypt as slaves. And as they toiled for Pharaoh and they were treated poorly, they cried out for their God. And their God heard them and sent Moses. And Moses came to Pharaoh with the message, Let my people go. And after much turmoil, Pharaoh let the Lord's people go. And then they came to a place called Mount Sinai, where God made a covenant with the children of Israel that basically said that he would be their God and they would be his people. That there would be a people that would worship the true and living God, and they would toss aside all their idols, and God would take care of them there in the promised land. God fulfilled his part of the bargain, but over time and over many years, it seemed quite clear that Israel was not intending to keep up their part of their bargain. There were years that they were good, and there were years that they failed. And so God prescribed a judgment upon them, that if they would choose not to follow him, that he would spew them out of the land. And so the time came where judgment would have been passed down on Israel. By that time, they had become two different nations, the nation of Israel and thus the nation of Judah. And so Israel was taken into captivity by the Assyrians, and Judah was taken into captivity by Babylon. After 70 years, those in Babylon were able to return. And thus began the rebuilding phase. But along with rebuilding came opposition. There are many of those who did not want to see the wall in Nehemiah's time get rebuilt. If we look at Ezra, there were many of those who were saying to themselves, can we ever rebuild something so great in regards to the temple? Might I say that this morning, as we look to the word, that we as a church, not just here in the Caribbean, but churches around the world, face a similar situation in which we have been hit, we have been rocked, but some of us, we are still standing. The pandemic, the COVID-19 pandemic, did not just bring with it sickness. It also brought loss of jobs, loss of family, and for some people, loss of faith. In the advent of us having to go into our households, many of us have taken the time to become weaker in our faith. No longer do we see the need to be in the Lord's house, but we say, well, we're doing streaming now, so then we could stream. And while the church has adapted into this streaming mechanism, and we are not against good technology, many of us know that streaming has no qualms on physical church and what it brings to the soul. We face a difficulty. We face a fact that we may have to restart. We may have to rebuild. And so therefore, the team has been given to me to preach on the issue, rise up in faith to work. As I would have prayed before, this is a theme of practicality. It's not necessarily something that I could keep preaching about, but really and truly, it is what has to be done. And so at every part of this theme, there is something that we have to look at. The first thing we have to look at is the fact that we have to rise up. Many of us would have suffered. Many of us may have experienced loss during this time, during the 2 years of this pandemic. You know, maybe we would have lost finances. Maybe we may have lost loved ones. Maybe it is that we are depressed and we are broken down, even as a church. Some of us, the plans that we had for 2020 and 2021, you know, we would have just put a stone in our spokes. And really and truly, we do not know what to do next. We don't want to plan anything in case there is a lockdown. We don't want to do anything in case we catch COVID. We don't want to share the gospel in case we come into contact with somebody. But as we look at the book of Nehemiah, we see first of all that there was a need. There was a need. There was a need to rebuild. And the wall had been laid waste for many years. There was no wall. And beloved, when there is no wall in a country, there is no security. Anybody could come in from any direction. They could raid, they could pillage, they could take what they want. And so Nehemiah saw the need to get up and to put himself to be the one to say, hey, let us get up, let us rise up and start rebuilding. Oh, beloved, we need men and women who would see this time not as a time to be complacent, not as a time to say, well, you know, nothing is going on, so then I'll do nothing. But to see this time as a time to say, well, we can do something. You know, one of the things I learn and I am learning as a believer is that where there is a will, there is a way. And who has taught me that lesson? Jesus Christ himself. Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 2 that he, being God, taught himself to be equal with God. But made himself as of no reputation and took upon himself the form of a servant. And being found in fashion of a servant, he became obedient even unto the cross. The Bible teaches us that Jesus was willing to go 100%. He didn't say to himself, well, the sacrifice that I'm about to make is too much. But he said, I will go, and I will die, and I will shed my blood for sinners such as you and I. Might I say, beloved, that we did not deserve his love. We do not deserve his goodness. But he still loved us anyway. As the songwriter said, alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die, would he revoke that sacred head for such a worm as I? I did not deserve his love. But he died for me anyway. So, beloved, as we know that he would have died for us, we know that where there is a will, there is a way. And in terms of rebuilding, in terms of getting back to where we were as churches, in terms of coming back from the suffering, coming back from the loss, we have to start the journey of 1,000 miles with one step. You know, many of us, we may be wondering about what if? What if now is not the time? What if? Beloved, might I say that God would tell us in his own time. But we cannot see the work of God and leave it to lie waste. There, we need as believers to carry on. To carry on. And to continue to do the work of God. Beloved, not because there is COVID. The Bible teaches us in the book of Timothy that we are to preach in season and out of season. Not because there is COVID, that means we do not preach. Because we are scared of COVID. Not because there is loss. That means that we do not preach because there is loss. Not because that there are people who have lost loved ones that we do not preach. We still have to, because God has said that we should preach in season and out of season. So it is time for the church to get up and do the work of God. We have to be willing to rise up. We have to be willing to say, hey, I am the one who will go, just like Nehemiah did. Nehemiah said, well, I see the need, I will go. Beloved, in your church, do you not see the need? I said, Pastor, what need are you talking about? There are many needs around the church. Ministry is not behoven or is not enclosed to the work on the pulpit. Is there a need for a Sunday school teacher? Is there a need for somebody to go and do witnessing in the community? Is there a need for somebody to clean the church? Is there a need for something to be done in the name and in the glory and the honor of God? Then rise up and do it. You know, beloved, many times we think of ourselves and we say, well, you know, I can't do much for God. Beloved, might I say this morning that you could do anything for God that you wish to do, as long as it's according to His word. But you have to be willing to rise up and do it. Now is the time to stand up. Now is the time to say, I am going to work. So after we've said to ourselves that we would rise up, we must rise up in faith. I say, Pastor, what do you mean that we must rise up in faith? You see, beloved, as I've said before, maybe we're wondering about what if. Maybe we're wondering about what if God is not ready for us yet. Might I say that we need to lock in to the promises of God. When Nehemiah went to restart and rebuild, note what he said. The hand of his God was good upon him. He knew that God had sent him, and he knew that God would allow him to build this wall. Beloved, might I say that in this time of rebuilding, might I say that in this time where we may have to start over, that we may have to go, that we may have to do some things over again. For some churches, they may be starting from scratch. For some churches, it may be that they may have to go out and reacquaint themselves with the community. But it takes first of all faith. You see, beloved, when the Israelites moved and they conquered the promised land, they conquered it in faith that the God who would have promised it to them was faithful to give it. That is the same God who we serve. And that same God has given us some promises that says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Many of us, we may be sitting in our homes and we may feel depressed. Maybe we've lost a loved one. Maybe we've lost some finances. God is still with you. Rise up in faith. Beloved, God never promised us a bed of roses. God never promised us that all would be well. But what he has promised us is that he will never leave us nor forsake us. And beloved, one of the things I'm learning as a believer is that we serve a God that could take evil and make good. Yes, the COVID pandemic has done us some damage. But in faith, we trust in a God that is able to take the damage that is done by COVID, the evil that is done by COVID, the evil that has happened in our lives, and he is able to turn it into good if we allow him to. Beloved, Do you trust in this God who is able to take evil and turn it into good? Because, beloved, we know. Yes, a lot has happened to us. Yes, our churches have suffered. Yes, we have suffered. But that doesn't mean that it wouldn't work out for good. The book of Romans teaches us that. The Bible tells us that all things work together for good to them that love him. Do you love him this morning? I ask this again. Do you love him this morning? And if you love him, you could go in faith, knowing that if you do anything, that what God is calling you to do, maybe God is calling you to be a preacher. You might be saying, now is not the time. Churches are not open. Might I say, you still need to go and preach. If that call is on your life, then go and preach. Maybe God is calling you to be a Sunday school teacher. You might be saying, no, it's not the time. It's not that time. Go ahead, because God is able to use what you're doing and make much. As the songwriter says, little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth nor fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. And beloved, might I say that we need to go in his name. We need faith to work. We need to go in that faith. We need to rise up in that faith. That God's work still needs to go on. God is not done with your country. Many, despite what we feel or what may have happened or what may have gone on in our churches, God is not done with your country. There are still people there who God wants to save. And as long as there are people, the gospel must go out. Many of us take that for granted. We look at people now and sometimes we don't even want to hear them cough. And that's okay. But as we look at our fellow man, as we look at one another, what we should see is not a sinner, but an opportunity. An opportunity that God is placing in front of us because he wants to see every man come to repentance. Bible teaches us that in Peter, that he is willing that all come to repentance. He wants all to come to repentance. He's not willing that anyone should perish. When you see your fellow man, do you see somebody who is in need of a savior? Or do you see somebody who you would just walk past? Might I say this morning that the difference in your looks will be the faith that you have in God. Yes, our faith will be challenged. Yes, our trust in God will be challenged. But God's word remains sure. The promises in his word remain supreme. And so we are challenged to do great things by him. But finally, not only must we rise up in faith, but we must rise up in faith to work. When I came to Baptist Bible College of the Caribbean in St. Vincent, that is where I studied, One of the things I learned about ministry was that it is hard work. And many times, and I would have seen many people come to Baptist Bible College of the Caribbean with great dreams intact. However, some of them left and they would have abandoned the work of God because of different reasons. Some, they took a wife. Some, they gained some land or some riches, and thus they didn't see ministry as a valid option anymore. Some had other reasons, but for many varying reasons, they chose not to enter the ministry. They chose not to be a part of God's work. Beloved, we could have a willingness or a desire to rise up. We could have all the faith in the world that God would do what he says he would do. But if we do not put our hands to the plow, then nothing would get done. Bible tells us in the book of Romans, if you turn there with me, Romans chapter 13, Romans chapter 13, Romans chapter 13 and verse 11, and he says, and that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. The night is far spent and the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying, but put ye on the Lord Jesus, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. Beloved, we are called to work. When Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 9, in Matthew chapter 9 and verse 30, let's turn there please. Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 9 and verse 37, he said to his disciples, the harvest is truly plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. He asked them to pray, but eventually they were the ones who ended up being the laborers in the harvest. Each and every believer is given the mandate to go into all the world and preach the gospel and share the gospel with mankind. We have been given a job to do. And so it is only our responsibility, if we want to hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant, that we go ahead and move forward and go and do the work that God has called us to do. You might say, Pastor, but the work is hard. The work has never been easy. It might be harder now, but still, there is a work to do. There is something that God has called us to do. And beloved, as we have read in Romans chapter 13, the night is far spent. We have wasted enough time already. We may have lost 2 years. Two solid years in this ministry. Now things are maybe opening up. Probably some of your churches are still under lockdown. But might I say that, as I've said before, where there's a will, there's a way. And still, the work of God must go on. It might not be, we may not have things the way that we had it before, but we should be able to work with the restrictions that we have now. It might not be how it used to be, but we still can be effective in the way that we choose to move forward. We have to understand that we have a mandate. And each and every day that we sit down, each and every day that we look at ourselves, we are wasting the Lord's time. Might be, beloved, that you have wasted enough time already. It might be that God is calling you and telling you, you need to get to work. You need to start to move and start to go out and start to do what God has called you to do. Maybe you've never thought about it, but you could go to your pastor and you could say, Pastor, I want to be used of God. But beloved, there is always a place for us in God's work. He doesn't leave anyone out. There is always a place for us in the ministry. It may not be that we would stand on pulpits and receive the fan service of men. It may not be that we may be a Sunday school teacher, but each and every one of us can be effective in a ministry. You might say, Pastor, but you know, I don't know where I can fit in my ministry, in my church. Might I say, beloved, that are there people in your house that need to know Jesus as Savior? You need to start working on them. That may be your ministry. That may be the ministry that God is calling you to. God may be calling you to be a missionary to your family. God may be calling you to be a missionary to your workplace. God may be calling you to be a missionary to your community. Might I say this morning that wherever God is calling you, would you go to work? I would say this, that we have an enemy that is hard at work trying to make sure that we do not succeed. In the book of Nehemiah, we read about two men called Sanballat and Tobias who wanted to make sure that Nehemiah did not succeed. And beloved, you may be listening to me right now and the thought may be going through your head that I may be speaking foolishness. Might I say that that is the enemy speaking to you right now? We have an enemy that doesn't want us to succeed. We have an enemy that is putting in 24/7 work, trying to make sure that the work of God does not succeed. Might I say that if we are truly God's people, that we are the light of the world, as he would have said in Matthew chapter 5, and we are the salt of the earth, as he would have said in Matthew chapter 5, and we are the city that cannot be hid on the hill, then we have a duty that we must do. As we stand as ambassadors for Christ, as we stand as ambassadors in his love, we must move forward. Because why? He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set himself free. But he chose to bear the beatings. He chose to bear the punishment. He chose to bear the mocking. He chose to bear the scourging. He chose to bear it all for you and I. Romans chapter 12. As we conclude this morning. Romans chapter 12. Bible calls us, and it says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. We are called to his service. We are called to work. We have not been called to sit down. God did not call you to sit down, beloved. He did not call you for you to warm pews and benches. He called you to be an effective part of the body of Christ. Now, as you look at yourself this morning, can you say that you are a blessing to your church? Can you say that you are an effective part of the body of Christ? Or is it that you have just been warming the benches? You've been warming the pews? You're only there in church to hear a good sermon or to hear something good about Jesus, but never really to act on it. Beloved, we are called to work. Rise up in faith to work. We must be willing to get up. Yes, we would have suffered damage. Yes, we would have suffered loss. Yes, we would have suffered so much. But still, God would give us the strength to get up and move forward. But not only should we rise up, we have to rise up in faith that God is with us. We don't rise up and walk blindly. We rise up knowing that God is with us and he would be there with us, and his promises remain sure in the word of God. Just as Nehemiah knew that God was with him, you have to know as well that God is with you. Is there a need in your church that you can fulfill? Is there something that is there, a gaping hole? Is there something that could be done, that you could do, that you could reach to someone, that you could tell somebody about Jesus? Is there a ministry that you could help in? Beloved, now is the appointed time. We go in faith, but we do not go in faith to do nothing. We go in faith to work. We go in faith to be effective in reaching the lost for Christ. We go in faith in the hopes and in knowing that we are trying to be a blessing to our churches. And we are trying to be effective parts of the body of Christ. Because I don't know about you, beloved. I really don't know. It's the first time I'm preaching here, and as I tell my congregation here in Trinidad and Tobago, I don't know about you, but I want to hear well done. Is that you this morning? Do you want to hear well done, thou good and faithful servant? I want to hear my well done. Maybe you are here this morning and you have lived a life that is not pleasing to God. Maybe you need Jesus of your own self. And you say, Pastor, COVID has done much, I have suffered much, but I know Jesus can make a difference. I want to know about this God who could take evil and make good, as you spoke about. Might I say that all you need to do is bow your head and speak to God and ask him to save you. Maybe you're here and you say, Pastor, I'm a member of a church, but I do not know where I fit in the ministry. I don't know what I could do. You know, there's so many things that have happened. The church has suffered. I have suffered. Might I say, you need to rise up in faith. Listen to the words that have been spoken. Yes, things have happened, but the work must go on. We must rise up in faith to work, because God's works, God is still in the saving business. Isn't that a wonderful thing? God is still in the saving business, and He is going to continue to save. Will you go out and be an effective part of the ministry? As we bow our heads, Father, I pray, O Lord, that as Your word has gone out, that, Lord, those who would view this broadcast, dear Father, Lord, I ask, O God, Lord, that You would challenge their hearts. I pray, O Lord, that in the name of Jesus, that, Lord, that You would have Your fullest way. And, Lord, that maybe even now that decisions are being made, but Father, Lord, these things we do ask that You grant. In Jesus Christ's name we ask with thanksgiving. Amen and amen. Thank you very much for the opportunity. And may God bless each and every one of you. Thank you.
Examining the work would be the following topic dealt with. And this topic will be handled by Pastor David Archibald from the island of Antigua.
I want us to have a word of prayer as we look into the Word of God, that God would speak to us through His Word, minister to our needs, and help us at the end of this encounter to truly draw closer to Him as we go forward in these difficult times. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word today. Thank you for the privilege to look at your word and to dig deep and to understand what you have to say to us. Lord, I pray that you will minister to every need. You alone know the hearts, dear God. And so we are trusting you, we are looking to you. And so we commit the time of the ministry of this word into your hands. Speak to us, we pray, dear God, by your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Our text is from Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 11 to 16. Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 11 to 16. If you have your place there, I would like us to read from verse 11 that says, "So I came to Jerusalem," and this is Nehemiah speaking, "and was there 3 days. And I rose in the night, and some few men with me. Neither told I any man what God had put in my heart to do at Jerusalem. Neither was there any beast with me, save the beast that I rode upon. And I went out by night by the gate of the valley, even before the dragon well, and to the dung port, and viewed the walls of Jerusalem, which were broken down, and the gates thereof were consumed with fire. And I went on to the gate of the fountain, and to the king's pool, and there was no place for the beast that was on me to pass. Then went I up in the night by the brook, and viewed the wall, and turned back, and entered by the gate of the valley, and so returned. And the rulers knew not whither I went, or what I did. Neither had I as yet told it to the Jews, nor to the priests, nor to the nobles, nor to the rulers, nor to the rest that did the work." Examining the work. Examining the work. Here in the book of Nehemiah, we understand that there is considerable difference, it has been said, in the tone between the book of Ezra and that of Nehemiah. Ezra shows us the remnant returning from Babylon and the first gathering in Jerusalem, that is in the land. But the book of Nehemiah shows us the same remnant at a later time, much of which is concerned with the rebuilding of the walls of Jerusalem and the tremendous opposition that was faced. Ezra differs from Nehemiah. Ezra is concerned about the deportments back to the land, and Nehemiah is concerned primarily about the rebuilding of the wall of Jerusalem. But we find something that's very interesting here in the book of Nehemiah, and we will look at that. But I want us all to understand that throughout the history of the Jews, we know if we were to go back and look at their history, where they came from, when God called Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldees, and he went forth, and the children of Israel, we know, of course, in Egypt and their slavery, them coming out of slavery, God delivering them, leading them in the wilderness through Moses, and then eventually Joshua leading them across Jordan into the promised land. And there were times when they would forsake the Lord, and they would come back to him, and God would have raised up judges, and he would have delivered them so many times. And because of sin, they were taken into captivity. And there was much concern. There was much, many of God's people were saddened because of the captivity and the Babylonian, the Assyrian captivity. But we find now that God is gracious to them. God is merciful to them. And he had said to them, if they would return, that he would have mercy on them and he would bring them deliverance. And so we find here now that under Ezra, there is a regathering in the land of Israel. And then, of course, we find Nehemiah as he returns, as he obtains leave and returns, we find that he takes time to examine the work. Nehemiah has already heard that the state of the remnant of the Jews, what their state was. He had already heard in reference to their state and the state of the gates being burnt with a fire. He had heard about the state of the walls being broken down. And then we find that Nehemiah, after mourning and weeping and fasting and praying, he obtains leave to go up to Jerusalem. And this is the part that we are concerned about here in this sermon. One of the first things that he does upon arrival in Jerusalem is that he examines the work and sees firsthand what was before him. Nehemiah takes the time out to examine the work that is before him. He wants a better understanding of what's ahead of him. He wants a better understanding of what there is to be done. And I do believe that in his mind, he is thinking about all that had befallen the children of Israel. He is concerned. His heart is touched. His heart is moved for the children of Israel, and so he examines the work. He takes a look at it, and I want us to examine the work today. When we speak about examining the work, we are speaking about inspection. And so to examine is to inspect. In this case, something, to inspect something thoroughly as to ascertain its true condition. As we speak of examining the work in this sermon, we are talking about the work of the Lord, especially identified in various churches, not only here in the West Indies, but across the world. This, though, can also be applied to our personal work for the Lord. Examining our personal work for the Lord. Let us look at two main points as we explore this topic of examining the work. First of all, the question is, the first thing that we need to understand is, why should we examine the work? I want us to be clear as to why we should examine the work. Some of us work and work and work and work and seldom stop to take a close look at the work that we are engaged in. We have become so busy. We have become so cumbered about with the things of this world and the rigors of the work of God that we seldom stop to examine, to take a close look at the work that we are engaged in. It is important to examine the work because it will help us to understand a number of things. First of all, it will help us to understand what we have done so far. It will help us to understand what we have done thus far. It will also help us to understand if we have done our best for the Lord. It helps us to understand if we have done our best for the Lord. I am sure we are all so familiar with the words of the song. The songwriter asks, I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus, who died upon the cruel tree? To think of his great sacrifice at Calvary, I know my Lord expects the best for me. The songwriter says, the hours that I have wasted are so many. The hours I've spent for Christ so few. Because of all my lack of love for Jesus, I wonder if his heart is breaking too. I wonder, have I cared enough for others, or have I let them die alone? I might have helped a wanderer to the Savior, the seed of precious life I might have sown. And then he says, how many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me? As we examine the work, it helps us. It's important for us to examine the work because it helps us to ask the question if we have done our best for the Lord. As we look at our individual works, as we look at our work for the Lord in our lives, have we done our best for him? This is a question that we need to ask today, that we need to be faced with if we have done our best for him. The last verse of the song says, no longer will I stay within the valley. I'll climb to mountain heights above. But we will speak about this towards the end of this sermon. But it's important to examine the work so that we can know if we have done our best for the Lord. Also, it's important for us to examine the work. This will help us to understand if we have worked with the right motives. If we have worked for the Lord with the right motives, it helps us to understand if we have been relying on the Lord. If we have worked with the right motives and if we have been relying on his strength, that is why it is important for us to examine the work. We also see by examination the strategy and approach of the enemy so we can know how to stand against him. When we examine the work, we see the approach of the enemy in we can see if we have been standing against him, if we have truly been fighting in the strength of the Lord. When we examine the work, it also helps us to see the actual state of the work, its strengths, its weaknesses, its highs, its lows. In examining the work, we are able to see what needs to change. But also it helps us to come up with a strategy of how we go forward. Many people are asking the question, even today, how do we go forward? How do I go forward in this difficult time, this day and age of pandemic? How do I go forward? We need to take the time out to examine the work so that we can come up by the grace of God and through his wisdom, a strategy of how we go forward. And so that is why we need to examine the work. But the main part of this has to do, and the second point is, how exactly do we examine the work? How did Nehemiah examine the work? And I want to share this with all of us so that it will help us as we go forward, examining the work. How do we do that? First of all, we look at our passage of scripture in Nehemiah chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. And first of all, we do this by asking questions. We do this by asking questions. Notice in Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. The king, the Bible says, said unto me, let me read from verse 1. It came to pass in the month Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes the king, that wine was before him, and I took the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. Wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid, and said unto the king, let the king live forever. Why should not my countenance be sad when the city, the place of my father's sepulchres, lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burnt with a fire? He says, why should not my countenance be sad? That's chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. But let's back up to chapter 1 now. Chapter 1, where the Bible tells us in verse 2 that Hanani, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah. It says, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. I asked, in verse 3, and they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burnt with fire. We're asking the question, how exactly do we examine the work? And the first answer we see in the book of Nehemiah is by asking questions. Some of the questions that we must ask are, have souls been won for the Lord? Have the saints been matured in the faith? What's going on in the work? You see, when we ask questions, we often get answers. Nehemiah received answers. He asked the question, and the answers triggered a major response in him. The Bible tells us here that he asked, or what does he ask? Concerning the Jews. He wants to know the state of the Jews. He asks concerning those who are left of the captivity. He asks concerning Jerusalem. The answer is the remnant are in great reproach and affliction. And Nehemiah, I want you to know, Hanani says that the gates are burnt with fire. The walls are broken down. But he asks questions. And in examining the work, we have to understand that it's important that we ask questions. We ask ourselves some questions. We ask others questions that we might get the information that is needed. And so how do we examine the work? We do so by asking questions. I want to encourage all of us to ask the questions. Ask the tough questions. Ask the difficult questions. This will help us going forward. We examine, first of all, we take this close inspection by asking questions that we might receive the answers, the information that is necessary that will help us going forward. Not only do we ask or we examine the work by asking questions, but we also examine the work of God with our hearts, with our hearts. In chapter 1, verses 4 to 11, the Bible tells us that when it came to pass, when I had heard these words, that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. In his prayer follows in verse 5, I beseech thee, he says, O God of heaven, the great and dread, terrible God, that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. He says, O God, let thine ear now be attentive and thine eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee day and night for the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee. Both I and my father's house have sinned. He says, we have dealt very corruptly against thee, and have not kept the commandments, nor the statutes, nor the judgments which thou commandest thy servant Moses. Remember, I beseech thee, the word which thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, if we transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. But if ye turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though they were scattered, were of you cast out from unto the utmost part of heaven, yet will I gather them from thence, and will bring them unto the place that I have chosen to set my name there. Now these are thy servants and thy people, whom thou hast redeemed by thy great power and by thy strong hand. And Nehemiah says, O Lord, I beg thee, let now thine ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant and to the prayer of thy servants who desire to fear thy name, and prosper, I pray thee, thy servant this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. I say today that we need to examine by asking questions, examine the work by asking questions, but also examine the work with our hearts. We see this in this response to what he had heard. When we weep and fast and pray, We are, in essence, looking at the situation of the work with our hearts. So it must be for us when we see things that drastically need to change as we examine the work. We must take time out to weep and to fast and to pray and to confess and to beg God to prosper our way going forward to build. We must examine by asking questions. We must examine with our hearts. I see Nehemiah here in such a graphic way, examining the work with his heart as he takes a close look and he hears of all that has happened, of the gates burnt with fire, of the wall that is broken down. He's looking at the work now with his heart. He's crying out to God. He's begging God. He says, Lord, I want you to hear. You have promised, God, that you will hear when your people pray before this holy place. And so, God, we are your servants. We have transgressed. And so he says, God, I want you to hear. He's examining with his heart. So we must examine the work of God with our hearts. It must not just be something that we take lightly, especially in these days in which we are living. We must examine the work of God with our hearts. But as we go a bit further, we see Nehemiah examining the work with his eyes. We must examine the work with our eyes. I want to go to chapter 2. And now, from verse 11 to verse 16. The Bible tells us, and we looked at some of this, but he says he came to Jerusalem. He was there in Jerusalem 3 days. And it came to pass, as he was there, he arose in the night, and few men that were with him. He had not, he said, told anyone what the Lord had put in his heart to do at Jerusalem. And there was just the beast with him, himself alone, and the beast that he rode upon. The Bible tells us that he went out by night by the gate of the valley, even before the dragon well, to the dung port. And the Bible says that he views the wall of Jerusalem, which was broken down, and the gates thereof were consumed with fire. He goes out, he views, he uses his eyes, he looks at the situation. The Bible tells us, as we read earlier, that he goes out to the gate of the fountain, the king's pool. There's no place that for the beast that was under him to pass. But he's again in verse 15. The Bible says, I went up in the night by the brook, and I viewed the wall and returned. And so he is examining the work now with his eyes. Here is where we see Nehemiah using his eyes that the Lord had given him to examine the work. Oh, we need to take the time out to walk around, pace back and forth, look at everything. Use our physical eyes, first of all, to view the work that we are engaged in. He walks back and forth. He goes up to one section and he looks at the terrible situation of Jerusalem. He goes a bit further and he examines the state of the walls and the gates. He views with his eyes. There are times in our different ministries that we need to do the very same thing. Examine the work with our eyes. We look at everything that God has placed in that particular location. Can we be doing something different for the Lord? Are we strategically placed to do what we are doing for the Lord? Is there something that needs to change? In a physical sense, there needs to be an examination of the work of the Lord. Well, oftentimes we don't talk about this. Oftentimes we don't hear anything about this. But there are times when we need to examine the work. Does it need to be a building project? Is there something that needs to change to better serve the people of God, to better serve the community? We need to examine the work with our eyes, physically. But not only that, examine with our eyes. Spiritually, with our spiritual eyes, we must ask God to open our eyes to see even what others are not seeing. Our eyes need to affect our hearts, like Jeremiah that said, "Mine eye affecteth mine heart." The weeping prophet, as he was in derision daily for the condition of, as he says, the slain of the daughter of my people. He said, "My eye affects my heart. What I see affects my heart. What I see physically affects now the spiritual, what I understand spiritually." And so we must examine with our spiritual eyes. If only we could truly see the work for what it is. If only we could see the world the way God sees it, no doubt we would serve Him more faithfully. Yes, we must examine the work of God with our eyes in a physical sense, but also in a spiritual sense. You know, I am reminded of an old song that goes like this. "Let me see this world, dear Lord, as though I were looking through your eyes. A world of men who don't want you, Lord, but a world for which you died. Let me kneel with you in the garden, blur my eyes with tears of agony. For if once I could see the world the way you see, I just know I'd serve you more faithfully. Let me see this world, dear Lord, through your eyes when men mock your holy name, when they beat you and spat upon you, Lord. Let me love them as you love them just the same. Let me stand high above my petty problems and grieve for men hell-bound eternally. For if once I could see this world the way you see, I just know I'd serve you more faithfully." Examining the work. We need to take the time out to examine the work by asking questions. Examine the work with our hearts. Examine the work with our eyes. Examine the physical state of the work. Examine the spiritual state of the work. Examine the fields that are white, all ready to harvest. Look at the situation. Take a close look in this year, in this time of our work for the Lord. Oh, for many of us, we have been serving for years in our various locations. We have been living for the Lord and doing this or that or the other for the Lord, and just serving and working and working and working. But there needs to be a time today when we stop and examine the work. In reference to the Lord's table, Paul says, on the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, let a man examine himself. And in the same token, we need to examine our own works for the Lord. We need to take the time out to say, "Lord, where am I? What have I done? What have I been doing? How have I been doing it? Have I been just concerned about building a kingdom here on earth for you and not building up your kingdom?" You see, when we examine the work and ask the difficult questions, it helps us to come to some conclusions and some answers that will help us going forward. We need to examine the work. How quickly has the world changed? And we all have experienced this, and we are living in a time like the world has never seen, at least for most of us in our lifetime. And so it is important for us to examine the work. What do we do after we examine the work? After we examine the work physically and spiritually, it should lead us to a certain conclusion. I want us to look now at chapter 2 from verse 17 to verse 20. Chapter 2 of Nehemiah from verse 17 to verse 20. The Bible says, "Then said I unto them." We saw how he examined the work with his eyes. And the Bible tells us in verse, let me back up to verse 16. "The rulers knew not whither I went or what I did, neither had I as yet told it to the Jews, nor to the priests, nor to the nobles, nor to the rulers, nor to the rest that did the work. Then said I unto them, ye see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burnt with fire. Come, let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we be no more a reproach." Then, after he examined the work, he says, "I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me, and also the king's words that he had spoken unto me. And they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for this good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite, and Tobiah the servant, the Amorite, and Geshem the Arabian heard it, they laughed us to scorn and despised us and said, what is this thing that ye do? Will ye rebel against the king? Then said I unto them, the God of heaven, he will prosper us. Therefore we his servants will arise and build. But ye have no portion, nor right, nor memorial in Jerusalem." Very important passage of scripture. After he examined the work physically and spiritually, and after we examine the work that we are engaged in physically and spiritually, it should bring us to a certain conclusion. And I say, as from our passage from the text, that it should lead us to strengthen in our hands for a continuation in the work and a further preparation to stand against the many enemies that will come against us. I want to repeat that. I don't want us to miss this. After we examine the work physically, after we examine the work spiritually, it should lead us to strengthen our hands for a continuation in the work and a further preparation to stand against the many enemies that will come against us. Oh, how we need to examine the work. But when we do so, what should we do? We should strengthen our hands. You know, oftentimes when people examine the work of God, they become weak. They say, oh, it's too much. It's like the 12 spies, the 10 spies that brought back an evil report. And they said, the enemy is too great. They are too many. We were as grasshoppers in their sight. We saw the giants. They saw giants. They saw it was too much. They came back and they sought to weaken the hands of the people. Oftentimes when people examine a work, and it seems too difficult, it seems like it's too much in this day of pandemic. Oh, as I've looked at the work, it's too much. We cannot accomplish the work, and the enemy would seek to bring us to that conclusion. But the conclusion should be one that's quite opposite. It says that when they heard what Nehemiah said, that they strengthened their hands for the work. Strengthen their hands. Not only says for the work, but they said for this good work. It is a good work. It's not just a work. We examine the work. It's not just a work for the Lord, but it is a good work. Oh, may we look on the work of God as good. They strengthen their hand, but not only that. Not only are they strengthening their hand for this good work, but the Bible tells us about Sanballat and Tobiah and Geshem. Oh, there always will be enemies. The enemies will come against us from the left and from the right and from all around us. The enemy will descend upon the work of the Lord and the people of God. But I thank God that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And we need to strengthen our hands for the good work after we have looked and seen the state of the work. We need to strengthen our hands for this good work. We need to continue to prepare ourselves to the power of God, the armor of God, for the enemy that will continue to come against us and the many enemies that will surround the work as we continue on, as we look forward to the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, the enemy, knowing that he has but a short time, will continue to seek to destroy the work, weaken the hands of the people of God, cause despair in the congregation of the Lord, and cause so many hardships, and cause the work to seem so difficult that to the intent that hands may be weakened. But we need our hands to be strengthened for this good work, because it is the work of the Lord. It is his work. And so we need to have a further preparation by putting on the armor of God to stand against the enemy. As we all look around us, we see the onslaught of the enemy. We see the advancement of the enemy as he will not back down. And so we as God's people need to not back down, but we need to stand firm in the strength of God. We need to have the armor of God. And we need to say to the many enemies that come that you have no right, no lot, no memorial. We will strengthen our hands for this good work. I want to encourage all of us not just to examine the work, but after we examine the work, to strengthen our hands and fill our, refortify ourselves through prayer and trust in God to help us to go forward. Days will be dark. Times are rough. Times are challenging. Many are going back and walking no more with the Lord. Many are forsaken the way of truth. There are so many challenges in the work that we oftentimes don't know where to turn, but we must say, God, I will, by your grace, strengthen my hands for this good work. I have seen what the situation of the work, I've seen the challenges, I've seen the ups, I've seen the downs, I've seen the ins and outs, and I've seen the things that are lacking, I've seen the despair of many, I've seen the confusion of many, I've seen the difficulty that so many are experiences, I've heard the reproach of your people, oh God, and as a result of this, I will strengthen my hands for this good work. Our hands can only be strengthened by the power of God. For I know that in my strength, and you know that in your strength, you cannot go on. We cannot accomplish the work in our own strength, but with the strength of God. It is not by might, nor is it by power, but it is by the Spirit of God. And so, examining the work. These are indeed challenging days. These are indeed challenging times. But we must take a time out. And what better time than the day in which we are living? We must take the time out to examine the work. My prayer is that God will help each and every one of us, that God will cause us to truly open our eyes. May we say, like the prophet of God prayed for his servant, Lord, open his eyes that he may see. The Bible tells us that the Lord opened the eyes of the young man and he saw. May God open our eyes to examine the work. May God open our hearts to examine the work through concern and prayer and fasting. And may God help us to strengthen our hands for this good work and fortify ourselves with prayer and saturate ourselves with the word of God for the good work. There are times when methods must change. There are times when the way we do things ought to change, but the Word of God remains the same. We do not compromise the Word of God, but we need to truly take a close look and see how we can do better for the Lord, how we can be wise in this time, this day and age for the Lord. So much has changed, but we need to see how we can do our best for the Lord, even in challenging times. May our hands be strengthened for this good work, examining the work. I want us to pray together. Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, it is so important, as we have learned and heard in this sermon, to examine the work. We have seen the importance. We have learned how we could examine the work. And I pray, O God, that you would help us now, each and every one of us, to examine the work as you would have us, and then to be strengthened for this good work. I pray, O God, that you have sealed all that has been said to our hearts. We give you all the praise, honor, and glory because you are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
Folks, you are reminded to join us daily at 8 a.m. for the classes. They're on Zoom, and the Zoom ID is 886-8010-1722. The passcode is 027990. Classes start at 8 a.m. daily, Monday through Thursday. At 1:15 p.m. would be the first speaker, and that's daily. 1:15 p.m., the first speaker daily. And that goes from Monday through Friday. At 7 p.m. nightly, Monday through Friday, would be our nightly services, singing and preaching. That's 7 p.m. nightly.